which is the E. If you look at it, this is to me the social entrepreneurship. You are here, then you move there. And M2 is to me the face of the spiritual entrepreneurship, where you think, what I can do for others. So I just thought I would share this story with you. I've said this many times, but I want to listen to it. So I will tell you. You see me standing here, and when I came to this country, I had almost nothing to do. My colleagues would say, Indian government used to allow you to take $500. That's all what my total salary used to be. Came here, went to Dallas, Texas. I never sat in a plane. The first trip was in a 747. And landing in Dallas and coming from the Dallas-Fort Worth airport to the university, the whole road was bigger than the entire state where I came from. You know, Texas is a city of distances. And I thought, how would I manage here to go to the university? Because there was no dorms or anything, because these all students were from rich parents. They used to come in Mercedes or BMWs to the school. Anyway, I figured out a very simple way that lots of students in my math class used to have trouble. So I went and helped them in their homework problems. From next day, I used to get 17 calls in the morning saying, Deepak, would you like a ride to the school? I can ask my own questions to you. In the evening, the same thing happened. 4 years I lived there. I never had any problem with the ride. More people wanted to give me a ride than I needed. And my advisor, who was from Texas, he was so proactive. I used to give him my paper in the evening, and in the morning he would have an answer. And sometimes he felt I was busy with the students. He says, why are you wasting your time with them? You need to focus on your PhD. So one day he called me and said, Deepak, I will give you a ride today. I said, no, I have already promised to a student. He said, that student doesn't have a Porsche. I just got a brand new Porsche, which is two-seater, and I want you to enjoy mine. I will show you how well I can go. He was a 70-year-old person at that time, still had the speech. Now, this happened. Somehow other got a job at the Catholic school. But this is where I want to bring this part to. Now, I, as I said, never been to a business school. Our dean at that time was Don Jacobs, who was the dean of the Kellogg School for 26 years. People, when I went for my job interview, and this was the day I'm here, actually it was November 13th and 14th, I left Kellogg School, 1985. He was not in town, and that's why I got the job. And he interviewed me, he would say, what an idiot this guy is, how can he teach business school students? Sometimes there is a blessing in disguise, so it happened. So a year later, there was a function. You know, we have this alumni reunion once a year schools do. So there was an alumni reunion, and I went, I thought I should see what business schools do with the alumni. But this concept was so new to me, because in India, a teacher is always a teacher. He would never come and ask, because he would believe that king do no wrong, a teacher can never be wrong, so you are a student for the rest of the life. This is how it is true. So there was a function of the alumni, and the dean has sent a letter to all professors, if you have time, come and attend the reception and dinner on a Friday. I was teaching, I taught my two classes, 1 to 2:40, 3 to 4:40. The reception was at 5:30, 6:30. So I went to this hall big, outside there was a reception. So somebody told me, the man in the center is the dean of the school. He is Don Jacobs. Now, in those days, the pictures were not that very common that you can see. So I thought I should go and convey my respects to him. I told him. Now, before I do that, he saw me and he said, come here. Are you new to this school? I said, yes, I have just completed my first year. He said, I want to tell you three things. First, these events are meant for senior professors, not for junior faculty members. Second, you junior people should be doing research, not eating dinners at the centers. before he could tell me the third thing, there was a person standing next to him. He said, let me tell you the third. And the third is, you should remember the first two for the rest of your life. There was a pin drop silence. There were 250 people. What do you do this? Now, one response is, you walk out. But my mother always used to tell me, when I went to school, she used to say that you never go up by letting others down. I thought if I walk away, nobody knows who I am, but everyone would remember the dean kicked out a new faculty member. So it would be more a reflection on him. I didn't say anything, because in those situations, silence is the best response. I decided, I just moved away, scared, I said, let me have the full experience. This is just the beginning. I just entered. The dinner was there. In those days, there was no vegetarian item. So the dinner item was only a glass of orange juice. So I had that. Went home. Next morning, it is Saturday, the dean of the faculty who was present there came to see me. And he said, Deepak, I'm very sorry to what happened to you yesterday. I said, these things don't bother me. I've said this to you before also. I really believe that every incident in life happens for a purpose. If you focus on the incident, you ask the question, who is to be blamed? If you focus on the purpose, you feel blessed that there is something good about it. So I told him, it was a nice learning experience for me, but I want to give you one advice. That when you join new faculty members as a faculty dean, you can tell us, where are there lines that we don't need to cross? I think that is a part of the reason. But he told me something. He said, you should not worry about it. I said, why? He said, he doesn't even know your name. I said, that's a big consolation. And he said, he has a very nice memory. He forgets things in 24 hours. So he won't even remember that he said this. Okay. To forgive is good. To forget is better. And to move forward is the best. So I told him that day that from today, I know what to do. And then 1987 to 1992, 5 years, I just focused on my studies, my research, and therefore I said in 5 years I became food. In 1996, if you remember, that was the era of internet. So lots of schools were thinking about how to think of internet as a way to teach. And there was a conference at Columbia called The Future of Internet Marketing. That was a very new area. In those days, many people didn't even have emails or things. And for some reason, I was asked to be a keynote speaker there. Because I teach a course called Customer Research and Insights. And they were asking that, how can we get better customer research? So that was on June 8th and 9th. On June 8th, this is on the 7th, my dean called my wife, Don Jacobs, and he said, I understand that Deepak is not going to be at the dinner tomorrow. Every year he used to have a very special dinner, which is called the Dean's Dinner, and this is like celebrating the year, which will be all this. Well suited, very formal. He will talk about the state of the school and about a very lovely dinner. I don't know how you remember my name now, so he's called my wife. He said, I want to speak to your husband. So she said that he just left for New York because he has to speak tomorrow at a conference. So she said, do you know the hotel? She gave the name of the hotel and the number. So around 12:35 at night, I get a phone call. So I thought, who can call you at the middle of the night? So I said, Sushant, my wife, who is sick? By that time, my son was just a year old, and the daughter was about 3 years old. I said, who is sick? The person said, this is not Sushant. This is Don Jacobs. My first sentence to him was, what did I do wrong? And I thought that, yeah, I've already been practicing. He said, no, there is nothing wrong. I understand you're not going to be the dinner tomorrow. I said, yes. So, I'm sorry I could not be here. He said, I want to make an announcement at the dinner. And I thought I should let you know what I want to announce first before I announce it to the public. I said, why should I be the person going first? He said, the reason is I want you to become my deputy dean. The same person who yelled at me wants to be, and there we didn't have multiple deans, only one. And he said, I want you to be the deputy dean and go back to sleep. And I haven't slept since then. The point I'm making is, you never get a chance to create, never get the second chance to create the first impression. But the first impression should not be the last impression. So when I came back, and I go back to the incident, the night that this happened to me in 87, some faculty members came to my office on Monday, the Saturday, and said, Deepak, we have one piece of advice for you. And I said, what is that? He said, you should leave Kellogg. I said, why? He says, the dean is so angry with you, and you don't know Dean Jacobs. He has two lists. Next person. Pardon me for saying this, but they said, he has two lists. A ship list and people waiting to be on that list. So you will never get tenure here. What I did was not intentionally, but I learned the lesson. So, if I don't get tenure based on merit, but not on someone's liking or disliking. So, just imagine. When I met him on the way after on June 9th, it just happened to be my birthday also. I said, why do you think? He said that in 1992, I had decided that you would be my next partner. And he said, I saw something in you, and I thought that you had the right values to run the school. A person who was nobody get to be the dean, which means there are certain things in you which people would value for. I'm just giving you a personal example that why this is important. At the end, this is the only sustainable part. So, what are the phases here? First is, I say, values create value. And realize that people are the only source of differentiation and value creation. Somebody can copy your products. Somebody can copy the services. But they cannot copy your. No two human beings are alike. That's why no two people would have the same fingerprints. Just imagine 8 billion people, 7 billion people, of that, no two people would have the same fingerprints. That means there is at least something unique about each person. The second part that I feel, and this is where the Florida International University needs a big discovery, is that education would lead to global peace. If you educate people, they would be less sick. Why do we have such a huge investment on healthcare? Part of that people are not educated to know what to do, and if you have nothing to do, you will get more sick. So if you are more busy because you don't think of others, you focus on the values. And to me, the key thing in the world is how you can educate as many people as possible. And the third is purpose before performance. Until now, we have all done from purpose to performance, from performance to purpose. But I think the new era, or the era of these people, is I want to study this because this is my purpose too. And the only way I can achieve that is through performance. There has to be people use this business language, you need to have a vision and others. I somehow other don't believe in this word, there are nice vocabulary to say. But the key thing is purpose and performance. The question is, they can be together, but the aim is that how you put purpose. So beyond thinking means going beyond business. But I want to tell you one thing. You have to have sustainable capitalism. If there is no money, you can talk anything you like, but how would you implement it? When we remember first time we met Bob, he was very supportive. But we needed people who can support, help us do that. And the people here, people elsewhere, people like Rajiv Jain, many others, came up and said, if you have a good purpose in mind, we will do that. The university said, if you can get X, we will match that. And it didn't take us much time to build this. So we need to move there. The second is, as I said, beyond success. And the third is, US and Europe are not going to be the role models only. It's not that you give up this, but you need to think beyond this part. And as I said earlier, that this Newton's law, when I was sick, I have created a whole list of physical laws, and I have implemented that to social science. So I'm writing a book called Nature Laws and Human Flaws. You know, you cannot go against nature. What has been sustainable over time? Lord Mahavira used to say that the universe is forever. Don't waste your time thinking of the origin and don't waste time. Because Mother Nature is always going to be there. It may have some changes, but the basic structure is going to be there. So if you don't believe in natural laws or nature laws, you would see what the human beings end up doing is human flaws. So my summary is, I took more time than I should have taken. Not that this I learned after going to France. The question is, if you want to build a ship, you can teach people what you need to get to do that. But the key thing is to create a design. And to me, spiritual capitalism is creating a desire in the kid, igniting that spark, and let them flourish. We are, as parents, to make sure of one thing, that our children do not get derailed. So if they are moving in that direction, we need to bring them. But the old model where we would tell, remember in India, people used to say, oh, you should study physics, math, or go to engineering school, go to medical school. There are only two, three lines defined. Otherwise, your life is unsuccessful in others. My father in those days used to say, go and become a government servant. You would never lose your job. So this is a very typical desire of a parent. You become an IAS officer, Indian administrative officer. But today, if you look back, I told him, I have no desire for that. So he said, what would you like to do? I will find out. And for some reason I got in 1968-69. My father was born with one eye and then he lost his other eye. So he could not support us. My mother never went to school. So I decided to study mathematics. Because for that you need a piece of paper and a pencil. We didn't have any college university, so just studied in the world. Never thought in the town I lived, we will end up in a place like Kellogg or now at INSEAD. People ask me, oh, so you live in the beautiful Paris. I tell them, all that glitters is not gold. And you can see and see what beautiful Paris is. Once you live there, then you see the miseries. What I mean is, as I said to every typical opposite reaction, that the city is the same infrastructure, but the traffic is increased. Where you could reach from one place to another in 45 minutes, only difference is now it takes 2 hours 45 minutes. And what is the most precious time for us? The most precious valuable is time. So our role as university teachers or parents, entrepreneurship is creating a result. That's something. You create something that the person would stand and say, I want to do this. scholarship does not mean I don't need to study. Because that will give you the tools, the techniques. It will show you what happens, why it happens. You need to know the knowledge. Then you start what you want to do. And then you decide what more you can do. So after going through all the sickness, I told my surgeon, the reason I came to Chicago back for treatment, because some of these doctors were my students. In 1996, I had them in my executive MBA class. Because it's very common now, people in healthcare to get a management education so they can move from healthcare to health management. So I thought that I know these people. And to me, medicine is there. So when I was returning back, I told the doctor that the medicines are more there to protect you. He said, what do you mean? I said, so that nobody can sue you. And you give the right medication, but people become better with the wishes of others. All the students I have taught over the years. My wife tells me, I didn't know you had so many friends. I said, people didn't have anything else to do, so they dropped a note. These 4 months when I was very sick,